All delegates and my dear participants, today is the sixth and last day of HPTC. The topic of today's session is advanced luminescent materials. I request all the participants to drop their queries in chat box at the end of this session. This session will be followed by validatory session. And now I would like to request Tulankar Madam to please introduce Dr. Murthy sir. Madam, please.
Thank you, Vankhede Madam. A very good morning to all. Today, we are on the verge of completion of this six-day STTP. Hope all the participants have had a feast of learning experience through the excellent and informative talks delivered from day one to day five by the eminent and scholarly speakers, Dr. S.V. Morel, Dr. K. Vijay Kumar Gupta, Dr. Anindya Datta, Dr. S. Omanwar, and Dr. K. Revatkar. Today, on this final day of STTP, I'm extremely glad to introduce to you all Dr. K.V.R. Murthy, President, Luminescence Society of India since 2012. He completed his PhD in the year 1990 from MS University of Baroda. He has been a professor in the Applied Physics Department since 2002 and is working as a Faculty of Technology and Engineering in MS University, Baroda. He has edited 48 volumes and books on luminescence and its applications. He is also the managing editor of International Journal of Luminescence and Applications. He has been associated with Luminescence Society of India since 1996, holding various positions like secretary, vice president, and president. He was awarded Fellow of Luminescence Society of India, New Delhi in 2008. He has worked in Boiron Labs, France, and awarded visiting researcher at AERIALCRT Research Center on Low Temperature Thermoluminescence. 16 students have completed PhD under his guidance and 25 students are working in collaboration with him. His topics of interest include light emitting diodes and phosphors, photoluminescence and lab display phosphors, nanophosphors for display applications, and thermoluminescence. He has published over 550 papers and completed two major research projects worth 5 million. He has also visited different countries for academic cooperation like the UK, USA, Germany, Italy, Denmark, France, China, Hong Kong, Netherlands, Poland, Singapore, and Malaysia. So let us welcome a person of distinction and eminence to give a finishing touch to this STTP. His topic for today is advanced luminescent materials. So over to you, Dr. K.V.R. Murthy, sir. So please
ask yourself. Can you listen?
Yes, sir.
Audible. Thank you very much for your kind words and introduction. And where is share screen? Share screen. Okay, can you see the screen?
Yes. Yes, we can see, sir.
Okay. I'll start the lecture now. Advanced luminescence materials and applications. Basically, luminescence research field is a fascinating field, and with day-to-day any applications, not necessarily a single, many applications are there. This presentation is jointly with R.P. Rao from USA. So we shared some of the research papers also earlier. So last 5-6 years, we are not much involved in this material. So day to day, wherever man-made light is there, like LED light, tube light, fluorescent, fluorescent lamp and compact fluorescent lamp, anywhere, whatever is there, the light are coming from there, or it is a cold light and converted light, and warm light is nothing but the light coming from your GLS lamp or bulb. So luminescence and phosphors, you must have heard from Professor Mahiril and Professor Vamanavar also. Here I give a different concept here. They must have talked about the material preparation, synthesis, and few general applications. Here mostly we concentrate in general nanophosphorus and applications and characterizations. But the application mostly we discuss are medical, cancer diagnostic, lighting and display, authentication and security, military or defense, and other applications, and some conclusions basically. So these types of luminescence, earlier speakers must have been discussed, especially photoluminescence, cathodoluminescence, electroluminescence. So in electroluminescence, when current is passed through a thin film, it gives a luminescence. Where that was clearly shown by Japanese scientist 1960, which was the first red emitting LED. Whatever red emitting LED is there today, you can see this light. So this light is nothing but a simple 635 nanometer. We can call as a laser, or we can call as a red LED. So last 50 years, almost 60 years, this red emitting LED people are using, and with so much bright and narrow application. So if you go to light emitting diode, so light emitting diode is a two luminescence concept. So one is electro, where because of semiconductor technology development, so bright, high bright blue LED was introduced in market by 1996 from Nichia Corporation, where Nakamura was the chief scientist. Once that blue bright LED was introduced, so globally there are 300-200 groups, luminescence groups, worked hard together and brought a material called Yagcilium garnet, C3+, which gives a yellow light. So here, once leads a white light, blue-yellow combination, RBG complex. Here, blue-yellow leads a yellow-dominated white light. That was introduced in 2000 in the market. From there, so tri-band phosphor, four-band phosphor, so now you name it, what are the lambda they can use, scientists can use the material using the blue light, or 395 nanometer UV LEDs also available at a cheaper cost. So if you go to other applications, are chemiluminescence, bioluminescence, sonoluminescence, tribo, fluorescence, thermoluminescence, optically stimulated anti-Stokes luminescence, that is infrared phosphor. So basic applications are security applications, these infrared phosphors are there. So authentication, medical displays, and having a simple luminescence phenomena, up conversion is called down conversion. So valency band to conduction band, electron goes when you excite, while coming down, some heat in the vibration state, and leads to give the light output when the excited electron falls to valency band. So the time, well, a conduction band to valency band coming, going up and down is 10 to the power minus 8 seconds or less, we call fluorescence. Afterwards, we call phosphorescence, and we call thermoluminescence. So many luminescence phenomena are there. So in up conversion, if you see, yttrium and left side erbium, right side thulium is there, TM. So yttrium electron goes to certain level, and from there, it can go to thulium. See that 1, 2, 3, 4 states there are from yttrium directly coming down. It is not giving any luminescence, non-radiative luminescence. Erbium, if you go, it can go to 1, 2, 3 stages. So what are the colors in erbium? You can see blue, green, red, 3 you can see. But in thulium, we can give cyan and blue. Only 2 emissions we can able to find. This is called when excited with 980 nanometers, that is infrared. So this is called up conversion process. So a simple storage energy receptor to emitter, a general analogy is given here, up conversion type. Anyway, definition of phosphor might have given by earlier speakers. Nanophosphor. Everybody knows the nanophosphors are the materials having a diameter size of 1 to 100 nanometers called nanophosphors or nanomaterials. So general application in medical is 40 to 70 nanometers. Non-toxic, you know, biocompatible, fluorescence wavelength depend on the chemical composition activators that everybody, all luminescence researchers know. In vitro and in vivo imaging and detection is always possible. Issues with scale up and potential toxicity concerned based on the composition. These are some of the fundamental properties of the nanomaterials to be seen while using. If you see the history of nanotechnology, you see the figures. Left side is a glass windows with nano gold silver from Rome Catholic Church. Right side is a cup, is a reflected light in no color. When you put a light from inside, you can see the image, red color image, where gold nanoparticle of 100 nanometers are used. Silver also nanomaterials used. So there is a subject called colloidal chemistry. So the colloidal chemistry today, a strong worded chemist, they always say nanomaterials we don't recognize since in colloidal time, that means suspended particles in a medium, maybe water, maybe alcohol or other, are nanomaterials. So we are working hundreds of thousands of years. The example is the left side, if you see the church glasses in Rome, or cathedral we call, so they are colored. By accident, because of earthquake, the church collapsed. And when the scientists are visiting that particular place, once collapsed, all glass panels are broken. So scientists collected different colored small glass pieces, went to the laboratories. They surprisingly found they are nanomaterials of gold. Nanomaterials of gold chloride. So that means 2000 years before itself, a nanotechnology was prevailing in the Europe, maybe in India also. But we don't have a record. There also no record was maintained. Here also no record was maintained. You can see that different precipitation techniques. So submicron powders of zinc was made, A, B, C, D, you can see. So A, you can see submicron is around 200 micron particles are there. And as a precipitation technique, time changes. So we have the diameter of the zinc sulfide increased. This is age-old material used for CRT tube. Zinc sulfide, terbium, nanophosphor for argo metal synthesis. So in our general applications, oxides of rare earth, Re2, AeO zinc oxide, sulfides, zinc sulfide, AES, rare earth oxides, zinc oxide sulfide, oxysulfide, halides, fluorides, chlorides, silicate, zinc silicate, yttrium silicate, AE silicate. Phosphates, rare earth phosphates, AE phosphates, borates, aluminates, tungstates, yttrium aluminate, garnet, yellow. So this is the material what I said, 98-99, scientists came up to give the white, yellow dominated white light. Silicon, aluminum, oxynitrites, this is materials, alkaline earth, silicon nitrides. These are two materials research started after 2001 onwards. By 2010, these materials in red emitting phosphors are used in LED phosphors. So chemistry of nanophosphors, we see host material, host activator, co-activator, doping method, how you dope it, morphology and surface treatment. So many of the luminescence materials, a surface treatment is always desirable. Why it is there? A silicon surface treatment leads more energy is absorbed and giving the high lumen output. quantum confinement, quantum size, surface area, surface morphology, band gap variation, shift in excitation. So these are the some of the processes to prepare the nanophosphor. Sol-gel process, chemical routes. Aerogel process, zero gel process, co-precipitation, solution processing, capping, cluster formation, electrochemical methods, CVD, chemical vapor deposition synthesis, emulsion liquid, membrane method. These are some of the chemical methods where less heat is there. If you go to physical methods, spray pyrolysis, spray flame pyrolysis, flame aerosol pyrolysis, solid state reaction, hydrothermal process, solvothermal process, combustion process, spotting, conventional molecular beam epitaxy. In molecular beam epitaxy and spray pyrolysis, the nanomaterials are prepared and are using now in medical drug delivery system. So they are very good technique, but very costly technique. Each a few milligrams are costing few hundred dollars. Or a gram of nanomaterial of 20 nanometers of this is costing around $1,000. They are very expensive. But for cancer treatment, they require only 2 to 3 milligrams. So along with the drug, they inject this material, and this material goes wherever cancerous growth is there, callus is there. It stays along with the medicine. When you take a mammography or X-ray, digital X-ray, you can see the colors over there. So wherever this material deposits, there you can see the color, and you can easily estimate the size of the cancerous. So some preparation variables are there. It's already, I think, Professor Muril must have given. Anyway, these are the general characterization method. So here we discuss some pros and cons of various synthesis. So solid state reaction is around 1200 degrees. Most of the phosphors are prepared. You can have a size of 200 nanometers to up to two micron or even more. We can able to separate this. Well crystalline particles, less expensive and less contamination. So cons are nano size is difficult to get, and we require suitable reactants. Sol gel, mostly oxides, 100 nanometers to 1 micron. Dispersion colloidal particles, high degree homogeneity. So mostly some of the nanoparticles we do prepared in our laboratory using the sol gel method also. CVD, chemical vapor deposition, capping. So capping can be done. Low temperature process, easy to scale up. Spray pyrolysis, oxides and sulfides. Mostly oxides are taken in the spray pyrolysis. Combustion, oxysulfides, sulfides. We can have very less combustion. Combustion is first invented in India only. So it is around 1995 in the Institute of Science. So 20 nanometer to 200 nanometer is one step process. Particle distribution is not uniform, and some contamination issues also there in combustion method. So for security, medical and lighting application, this spectral energy distribution of nanophosphors are being discussed here. So left side top, lambda excitation 980, that means up conversion phosphor. This is, you can see the up conversion phosphor, what are the emissions. Okay, so right side lambda excitation X-rays, they didn't give the lambda here. X-rays having a wide band, lambdas are there. Very good intensity. And then 1550 IR, C, left side down is C, and right side down is 390 nanometer excitation giving emission in the visible region. So these are the some of the emission excitation characteristics of some materials used. So up conversion lambda at 980, you can see the emission from blue up conversion phosphor, emission from other up conversion parts. The nanomaterial applications or opportunity in medical are high resolution digital mammography, biological imaging, dual optical magnetic resonance imaging, photodynamic therapy, x-rays, solid state lighting, anyway, that is basically present LED market, microdosimetry, point of care radiation, biodosimeter, immunoassay, computed radiation, radiographic imaging, CRI, tagging, that is biotagging, and labeling of human blood cells. These are the futuristic and present some of the applications already in use. If you see fluorescence spectra of the material, nanomaterial from healthy and malignant tissues. Healthy tissues is the blue one. So there is no emission around 635, 640 nanometers. But when malignant cell is excited with the same, so we have around 635 nanometer emission. So by looking into this blood fluorescence, we can easily say that this is a cancerous blood and this is non-cancerous blood. Simple application. So using this nanotechnology, nanomaterials, luminescence, nanoluminescence materials in principle, so we can able to have new solutions for cancer curing. So many ways we can have, okay? In vivo imaging, molecular imaging and early detection, multifunctional therapeutics, prevention and control, research enabling. So these are some of the basic applications. Anybody can read from the internet. They are available. This is a suggestion: we must accelerate progress against cancer. Early diagnosis is key. Using some of the luminescence nanomaterials, so we can have a breast cancer, all stages 86%, around 86% immediately you can see. Local 97% you can able to recognize. And colon and rectum, liver, lung, and see, liver is only 6.9, local 16.9. Lung also is better when compared to melanoma. What is melanoma? Is nothing but a skin cancer. So using simple nanotechnology, putting nanomaterial over there, 96% we can able to see. See means detect, ovary, pancreas, prostate, and test. So using this nanomaterial, nanoluminescence material, we can able to detect the cancer early stages. Basically, this is a conventional radiography. They put a screen and phosphor screen, film in between, and then take the x-ray, and you will get the digital radiography. Conventional radiography, film. So then we have storage for phosphor plate and readouts. Now, most of the x-ray units, see old x-ray unit, they are using 30, 40 year old, but they changed the plate. So the plate with new phosphor enables you to take a readout from a machine. Basically, there is inside, there is an optical scanner is there. It scans out the figure and the figure is digitized and immediately stored to a computer with a software. So the software person or operator just to increase the tints and the final picture and take the printout. Or sometimes you're not required to take printout. Already the image is sent to the doctor. With no time, the doctor knows what it is. This where a very good example of phosphors are used presently. Computer radiographic imaging. So a simple image, a center is earlier type. Now you can see whatever you want, you can do with the image. You can increase, decrease tint, you can change. And finally, we can locate what is the defects at a proper place. Since the data is digitized and proper software, we should use. So this is one of the good technique, optically stimulated luminescence microdosimeter. So if I remember well, so this KDK College, your convener Vankadeya madam having a patent on this optically stimulated luminescence dosimeters. They are also very good and good material, L2O3C, I think she used. and prepared the different techniques, and she got the patent. Breast cancer detection at early stage using the digital mammography. Here, in mammography basically it is a breast cancer detector only. So what it is there using a digital thing. Lower radiation, you can increase, decrease image quality, what you want. Lysander detection, diagnostic efficiency, full field digital mammography, computed radiography, computer assisted radiography, 3D mammography, contrast medium mammography, dual energy imaging techniques. So with a simple one radiography, you can have so many things. You can use that through a appropriate software, you can able to do. So how it works, high resolution digital mammography, you can see that. So cross section of channeled nanophosphor structure. Okay, so because of nano structures are there in a proper array, so it is easy to resolve this radiographs. Another is photodynamic therapy. So photodynamic therapy normally used for unique prodrug activated by light, mechanism of activation. So you can see that mechanism activation, you activate. So the second one is drug is excited. Formation of excited state and then emission. From emission, we can able to image the emission and take care of what is happening. So mostly these experiments are in the final stage in the mouse, and subsequently it may come to the human testing. So if you use IR980 nanometer, supposed to be a red. Okay. So upconversion phosphor inside the chest cavity. So you can see the color, yellowish color, you can see that. So 980 nanometer is excitation and output is yellow color, chest cavity. Once you put that, it goes inside, output you are getting is a yellow one. This is already people are working on this. Mostly device must be ready now. Infrared and sunstone. So some of the applications are discussed. Metabolic activity is high. IR only, IR plus photon. IR plus sunstone, IR plus photon and sunstone, all combinations. Basically, IR only having a better application. Dual and optical MRI, magnetic resonance imaging of nanophosphor. That is X-ray contrast comparison. Anyway, X-ray is there, so it's falling, and a CCD is there, charge coupled device. And then this is a unit. Finally, you can see the colors, green, red, high, 635 nanometer is there. So fluoroscopy, if you use, high red is coming. You can able to white light to fluoroscopy to XL1 white light. So we can analyze using the output, since there the nanomaterials, nanoluminescence materials are applied in the chest. Here, radioluminescence in nanophosphor for bioimaging. ABC are rats are there, and you can able to see when the luminescence material is injected, wherever cancer is there, it is giving red color. After treatment, right side, if you see a central B1, you see, is tumor minimized, and C, after 1 month of treatment, the tumor disappeared in mice. So then we'll go to nanomagnetic materials. So they are also used in drug delivery system. Preparation techniques are very different than your luminescence nanomaterials. Radiotherapy combined with the MRI. And this, especially these are called magnetic forgotten the magnetic rheological materials, that there magnetic fluids also it is sometimes called. So there, that is used in drug therapy as well as automobile braking system, and especially nuclear industry, nuclear power plants, they are used in the bearings, like in sub grease they put this magnetic material and apply magnetic field, so no leakage of radiation from inside in the maybe in the air or in the water. So this is one of the best materials, magnetic nanoparticle materials. Okay. So if you engineer a nanomaterial, nanoparticle size is reduced significantly and simultaneously enhance the magnetic strength and light efficiency. So composite magnetic luminescent nanoparticles of 100 nanometers. Magnetic nanoparticles of 5 nanometers. If you see that light is falling, there is a coating, magnetic coating on the inside light particle is there. So energy is falling, finally we'll get a light from the encapsulated nanoparticle. From light output, we can able to analyze what is defects of the particular cells. So this is simple steps how nanomagnetic materials are created or prepared. So conventional, we'll have a big magnet. But non-conventional and nanomagnets, if you see, central one is a nanomagnet prepared in the laboratory. If you see this figure, there are 50 nanometer magnetic nanophosphors are there. So you put a light, T is equal to 0 minute. That is a color. T is equal to 2 minute. That is a color. T is equal to 4 minute. What is happening is whatever the purple light is coming, is slowly intensity is reduced. Okay, the magnetic nanoparticle can simultaneously move under the external magnetic field and detected when excited by a UV lamp. Okay, so this patent also pending in USA. So what is happening is when magnetic field is applied for a nano magnetic phosphor, so they align together. When take out from that magnetic field, put your UV light of 254.7 nanometer. So light intensity, a flash you give, light intensity is there, purple color. Remove it, slowly intensity reduces. By sometimes your particles are different, this time is different, and the time increases or decreases and intensity increases or decreases by depending on the intensity and time, we can able to estimate the defects in the cells. So advantage of magnetic nanoparticles are a functionalization of and drug delivery. So one drug is coated with a magnetic nanoparticle, and a protective layer also coated during drug coating MNPs. So once they can be localized under a magnetic field at a targeted place, suppose you inject it and they are localized someplace. So using external magnetic field, you can able to slowly drag wherever cancerous part is there and leave there. Okay, so there is a magnetic particle and as well nanoparticle. So once you use a variable magnetic field applied, so the domain changes the direction as per the external magnetic field speed. So once it is continuously changing, heat develops. When heat develops above 50-55 degrees centigrade, so the cancerous cells started dying. So use this therapy randomly for a week. Majority of the cancer cells die at a particular place. So further growth may not be there. So this is non-invasive, no irradiation is required, no operation and other drugs are required. So by sending, you can reduce the tumor growth. You can see that. So you can add the anti-cancer drug also along with the external magnetic field. So which results in cessation of the growth of cancer cells and necrosis of the tumor. This is already published literature. So this is left side is a solid tumor. We inject the material and put a magnetic field direction there. So all the nanomagnetic particles along with the drug deliver. Drug goes there and stables. And the drug affects the cancer cells. And again, the varying magnetic field also kills the cancer growth or cancer cells. Apply magnetic field, reconcentrate the particles. Normally, chemotherapy is used for many cancerous stages. And before, some are without therapy. Some are without operation, some with operation. This chemotherapy is continuously used. They are having many, many side effects. However, using drug nanoparticles, the drug delivery system drives the particles to tumor, minimizing harm to healthy tissues. This lowers dosage, improve efficiency, limits systematic toxicity and the effects of side effects of the chemotherapy. So, magnetic nanoparticles also plays a major role. You can see that. Next one is solid state lighting of nanophosphor. Molecular imaging in combination with blue LED, bonded ligand receptor for tumor detection, diagnosis and therapeutics in combination with HB blue, high bright blue LED. Interior light for various applications, example surgical theaters, homogeneous and shadow free lighting, the cinema theaters, not cinema theater, movie making or TV serial making, this is homogeneous shadow free lighting, lack of radiation and heat. The LEDs heat is very minimum when compared to flashlights or your floodlights earlier was used, which leads a comfortable environment in the studio. Required color temperatures and precise examination of human tissue. Tuned LED lighting to treat various skin diseases. So this leads, as I said, now LED technology is so advanced, whatever the color you want, from 400 to 650 nanometers. So we can have a band of laser. A laser also narrow band. So we LEDs also, you can get a narrow band through phosphors also. That is what it is. Since all three-phase emissions are spiky, very narrow band they can give. Recently, I found in the literature, laser lighting. So laser white light is a concept and nobody is saying what is the technology. It's a new, brand new BMW 7 series. They are giving headlights with laser white light, which can focus up to 2 kilometers without any deviation. So that is a technology already coming in the market. So research is going on white lasers. Concept is new for us. Some of the development of upconversion phototherapy for biological sensors. Here, high sensitivity during zero optical background, no other material in the nature. Many unique colors exhibited by the same laser for multiplexing. Robust, no photo bleaching. Diode laser readout providing for compact, long time, long lifetime sensor. So earlier, even so, gas lasers use, it is having a life of hardly 2000 hours. Subsequently, solid state lasers has come. They have a life of 20,000 hours. Now the life of semiconductor lasers is hardly as high as 40,000 hour usage. So detector also, life also increases. And source life also increases. That leads cost is reduced. Some of the basic applications are discussed here. Hybrid LEDs with a high RI, non-composite, nano-composite and nano-phosphor. Basic phosphor emission is 470 nanometers, that is blue light coming from basic LED. So using high blue LED, now you are getting around 200 lumens per watt. In market, 140 to 150 lumen per watt LED is also available. Finally, in the laboratories, is 200 lumens per watt now available. So where transparent nanophosphors are used. So where what is doing is increase refractive index from 1.5 to 1.8 nanocomposite. Enhance lighting output by 40%. So this is what nanotechnology, nanoluminescence materials a miracle in lamp industry, especially lighting industry, LED lighting industry. So instead of earlier, when first LEDs was introduced, it was 40 lumen per watt, 40 to 50, 60, 100, 80, 100, 2003, 80 lumen, what at the time, this tri-band fluorescent lamps are there, they were giving around 80 lumens. And subsequently, it surpassed. Now 140 lumen per watt LEDs are available in the market. So most of the phosphors are developed in different countries, but manufacturing in China. So China is a global leader in supplying the phosphor, whatever you want, they supply, they have. Earlier, 20 years before, it was Japan they used to do, and Philips, Europe, especially Netherlands, I visited their laboratories twice. So Philips laboratories, they used to manufacture and send to global. So Nichia Corporation, Philips, and Japanese company, now Chinese companies are overruled everybody. Since cost of Chinese manufacturing is only 15 to 20% when compared to the same material produced in other countries like US and Europe and Japan. If you see the nanophosphors left side under normal light, the yellow and white and others, and put under a blue light, blue LED, that is 470 nanometer, see that. So cyan color and orange red color and white is there. And the application of solid, wherever they are, there are many applications there. Diagnosis and therapeutics in combination with interior lighting for various applications, homogeneous, shadow-free lighting, lack of radiation and heat. See, that is a major important. Earlier, when we used GLS lamps or discharge lamps, a lot of heat used to be developed in the operation theaters. So the doctors used to sweat. Once an LED lighting has come, immediately they throw old lights and put new lights. There's less power, almost no heat. It is there, but compared to earlier, it is hardly 5%, which is not felt by the person, since they are away from around 3 to 5 feet away from their doctor's body. Tuned LED lighting to treat various skin diseases. Anyway, you see that there are now, as per literature, there are around 200 light emitting diodes. 200 types of LED lamps are used for a modern car, big car. Okay. So including LCD TVs, indicators, GPS system, dashboard, displays. When you open the door, the light is glowing. So many. Finally, what I want to say is entire lighting system of a car is controlled through a software. There is a big hard disk and a big software is there which drives many, many parameters of the car. Anyway, quantum dots. So in room light, we can see a transparent white quantum dots are there. The same is excited with the 365, how what color we are getting. 400 nanometer, cyan, bluish, green, whatever we're getting. 470 nanometer, in the same material you put to quantum dots, is a green color. So that is the definition of the quantum dots. Quantum dots of the different sizes with the same excitation gives different color. But a same size with a different excitation gives different color. There is a quantum shift, we call. There is a quantum shift of around 30 to 40 nanometers leads the green light when excited the 470 blue light. And near UV LEDs for LCDs, blue light. This is a concept already working in the devices. Authentication. Nanophosphors crystals, nanophosphors under UV light. Visible down conversion and invisible up conversion. Easy to mix with inks and coat by inkjet process. Unique signatures compared to bulk phosphors. Possible up conversions are Re2 oxysulfide, Re2 erbium, yttrium, erbium, thulium, yttrium, gadolinium, lanthanum. So product authentication. So the product is costly products. So how to authenticate? So put a tag there. See that tag. Left side top, converter sterilized tracking code and sterilized tracking code at different places. So the whatever the costly product is coming, so they put a nano dot there, nanoluminescence material, and through scan through a IR. So a particular color earlier what I showed. See the different wavelengths give different colors. Different colors. Like that, scanning also, different lambdas gives different colors. So these can be used, these are used presently for authentication as well as the soccer, football tickets, which are costing around $5,000, $10,000 for a particular season. There they print this with mixing with a ink. That is only for a particular lot. Then your currency notes. So somewhere nanomaterial dot is there. If you put under a UV light, a particular color will come. And especially this technology is used since long in passports, identification of the passport. When you go abroad, first you give the passport to the passport control. They take the passport, keep under the UV light. There a particular color is coming from your passport, that is original. Color is changed, that means a duplicate. A simple thumb rule, luminescence materials are helping to the security personnel. See, pharma products also, costly pharma products which are 5,000 rupees and above. So they are labeling through a nano luminescence material. So security cover technology, FBI estimates the USA loses approximately 250 billion annually due to control. See, there is a say in US, almost 20% of US currency is fake currency. But still they accept it, they don't want to. So they try to give. So earlier they used to have a ink marker, they put a ink mark there. So color changes, that is duplicate, color not changing, that is the original. Now everybody is getting that 980 nanometer laser source. So mostly you say currency is very less used, cash is less used. Mostly it is a credit card, debit card system. See, Africa is 50, Asia is 30% counterfeits. India, there is no value. In Malaysia, it is interesting. Every year, they change 100% currency. So plastic currency notes are there. Every year they change. I asked why you are changing. Every year 100% fake currency is putting by the public into the market. So they take out and give new currency. By that way, they send a lot of money. So barcode readers. So what are barcode is there? What is barcode? One should understand. And the market, if you go to the malls, there is a lines are there. That is called barcode. Put under a IR. So it detects and gives the price. What is the product? Everything it gives. So that is called barcode technology. Mostly using LED scanners. Phosphor barcode system also coming for mini gratings. Some of the phosphors and PL spectra used for LED applications. So here it is not that much easy to engineer the reverse engineer the phosphor blend where we are using for counterfeit notes or passports. In defense application, if you see, left side top, there is a aircraft traveling at around 1,200 kilometers per hour. And then which is focusing on the vehicles as well as the houses and installations. So there, military applications, wherever military areas are there, they put a nanophosphor coating on their device, on their vehicles, on the devices, on their armors and the installation. So we flight traveling at 1,200 kilometers per hour can put a 980 nanometer light there. The phosphor gives a particular green color or a red color. So they are there. If the color is changed, they are not their enemies. So they bomb that. So some of the specific of defense application of nano luminescence materials. Remote therapy. Some are phosphors in harvesting solar energy. This is interesting now. Whatever solar energy is converting is all blue light is blue mostly absorbed and converting this silicon solar cells. Now we have many materials which absorbs IR also. Around IR. 750 to 1000, it absorbs phosphor and gives blue light. By coating this material, we can increase 78% efficiency of the solar cells. So some of the challenges, what we can manufacturing, environmental impact, regulations, personal safety, health risk, toxicity, storage and cost. So storage is not an issue. We can all the inorganic materials and toxicity is a minimum, health risk are minimum. Regulations, only regulations, what type of materials you should use. Some of the governments having their own regulations, not like in not India. We can use any material and develop our own material. So 2018, what are the worldwide phosphor production you can see? So it is almost a billion dollar industry, fluorescent, LCDs, PDPs and others, X-ray films, radiographic films, TL dosimetry and others. So much so, total, it is, defense application is only 15 million and others together 100 million. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you, sir. 8 minutes. Okay. Thank you, sir. It is for us such a wonderful, valuable, informative session on luminescent materials and its applications. It is really fruitful for our participants. Now, this session is open for discussion. Dr. Archana Madam will ask questions in chat box. Over to Archana Madam. Archana Ramteke Madam.
Thank you very much for my members, Luminescence Society members. Many are, okay. I can see many members
okay,
are there.
Okay.
As a participant.
Yes. Dr. Archana,
yes,
Madam?
Sir. Yes, okay. Thank you so much, Madam. Very good afternoon to all of you. I, Dr. Archana Ramteke, starting with the question answer session now on the last day of STTP. I request all the participants to please stay connected and please put your queries in the chat box. It is open now. First of all, I am really very much thankful to Dr. Murthy sir for giving such a very high end information on advanced luminescent materials. Really, sir, it is fruitful to hear you.
Thank you.
Sir, I'm starting with the question answer.
Welcome.
Sir, the first question has been asked by the Archana Deshpande madam. I want to know about what are the future perspective in thermoluminescence?
The thermoluminescence applications are already well established. So only you have to have a materials with high intensity for less dose. So that materials research is still going to be there another two decades.
Next question is from Dr. Rujuta. Nanoparticles used for drug targeted delivery is used in which form?
Nanoparticles.
Yes.
Nanoparticles are mixed with whatever the drug we are delivering. Okay, so the drug is designed such that it will go and stay only wherever malignant, that means cancerous cells are there. It may be rotating, is moving along with the blood. So finally, it goes and settles with the cancerous part. So along with the drug, nanoparticles are there. So once we put in an X-ray, so it gives a distinct color. Okay, that is a PET is there. So distinct colors they give. So magnetic nanoparticle, again, it is different. So it goes along, you can directly inject into the cancerous, which we know that wherever it is there. If not, you can put with the as an injection, they go and stay and use the alternating magnetic high alternator. So by moving the nanoparticles, and it gives the heat and kills the cancerous cells.
Sir, then, what is the exact effect of change in refractive index?
Change in refractive index as the density varies. Density of the material varies. Refractive index varies in the glasses. So there, in luminescence materials, it's 1.5, you go to 1.8 with a lesser size. The size reduces, so this mu also varies. So there, 1.8 refractive index comes for 102 nanometer size. So that leads more absorption of the material. So density is more absorption of the radiation, maybe X-ray, maybe gamma.
Okay. Sir, next question. What are the basic criteria for material to be nanoluminescent?
See, there are no criteria. The majority of the nano research is trial and error. We do say 30-40 materials, so only 4 or 5 may be giving good luminescence. Using solid state reaction also, 50% materials may not give any luminescence. It's mostly trial and error. We cannot calculate, we cannot simulate. Okay, but Dr. Doble, given a software, we can simulate. But what is the practical, it is only 2-3% we can after simulation, only 2-3% we can get an experimental.
Sir, next question from Dr. Mahesh. What is the role of annealing in the phosphor materials? Is it possible to create defects in host material by annealing treatment for high temperature?
Basically, annealing treatment is only to remove the defects, not creating the defects.
Okay.
So if you anneal it, you then defects can be created. So in fast normal is a powder, it is not possible. If you put it again in water, so it absorbs water, your luminescence properties will come down to 50%. Again, you have to
online program due to the pandemic. So participants could not visit the college.